Amen. Well, that was quick, almost too efficient. That's right. I look forward to the offering time because I like to socialize a little bit kind of right there, and I know you do too. So, yeah, drag your feet a little bit more. Have you said good morning to whoever's sitting next to you? How about who's behind you or in front of you? Can you just, yeah, good morning, huh? Amen. We have some guests this morning. Blessings to you. Welcome. Something that has been kind of a major deal on my heart lately is making sure that we as a congregation and that you as a disciple of Jesus really understand how the kingdom works, how spiritual things work. I think sometimes we kind of feel like the kingdom of God is sort of like Disneyland. You know, you come into the vicinity of the magic castle and, you know, you throw some money in the wishing well and, you know, all this hoping and praying and, you know, waiting for a miracle and all of that. And yeah, it's a kingdom of power and miracles and wonders and yeah, everything about the kingdom of God is great. But how does it work? What are the principles by which this kingdom that we are citizens of, how does it function? We know how a democracy functions. You know, we can oftentimes complain about who is in office, and then we find out that all of our neighbors who feel kind of politically in line with you, you find out after the election that was lost to someone you consider an opponent, you find out that none of your neighbors voted. And it's like you're thinking, doesn't anyone understand how a democracy works? We've got no right to complain if we don't know how the system works or if we don't participate in the system when we do know how it works. So that's usually the two problems in a governmental system. People either don't know how it works and are complaining, or they do know how it works and they're just not participating according to the rules. How many know the kingdom of God has rules, or we might call them principles, or axioms, mottos? I don't care what you call them, but the basis for those, the very core of how the kingdom works, is found in Matthew chapter 5, where Jesus went about preaching the kingdom. And in Matthew chapter 5 is one of his very first sermons. And he continues to say the kingdom of heaven is like, the kingdom of God is like. And he starts out with that word blessed. Everybody say blessed. Blessed. The blessing is a primary principle of how the kingdom of God works. And a blessing is by many definitions that are variations of what I'm about to tell you is the definition. It goes like this. A good word spoken. It could be a good word released. It could be done with the laying on of hands. But something has to be said. And out of that, we extrapolate a principle of the kingdom of God, that the kingdom of God is, if it's nothing else, it's a voice-activated kingdom. The way we participate in it is by giving voice, vocally, speaking. And the primary thing that we are told, and at the end of Matthew chapter 5, we are told, bless and curse not. So here again, if you're speaking words that are negative, critical, curses, you are activating something. And you don't want to do that. So Jesus kind of sums up the chapter with that thought, bless and curse not. In other words, watch our words, but make sure we're speaking good words. We don't want to be going through the motions, okay? So whenever we are giving, it's an expression of love. But we also want to say something. Faith speaks, love speaks, right? You know the story. You know, the old guy, they're in marriage counseling, and the wife says, he hasn't told me he loved me for the last 30 years. Then he says, well, I've been faithful to you, and, you know, always come home at night and always provided. And she goes, yeah, but you haven't told me you love me for 30 years. And he says, I told you I love you the day we got married. If I'd have changed my mind, I would have said something. And so here's a guy who knows the importance of words, but then again, he doesn't really know the importance of words. He knows that when you say it, that's the way it is. But how many of you know you got to do more than just say it once? A daily would be nice, wouldn't it? And every morning, I love you, sweetheart. Isn't that what our hearts really long for? So it's our love is expressed in many ways, but one of the primary ways is by voice. This guy did everything. He did all the providing. He did all the serving. He did all the, you know, he did all the love language stuff except provide the words. And we want to provide the words. Jesus is talking about in, I think it's Matthew chapter 13, he talks about the parable of the sower. I'm not sure if I got the chapter right on that, but at the end of the parable of the sower, Jesus basically, in explaining it to his disciples, he says this: if you understand the parable of the sower, you'll understand all the other parables. That was like the key to understanding the rest. And we call it the principle of sowing and reaping. Sowing and reaping. If you understand sowing and reaping, you'll understand all the other parables. But really, sowing and reaping is, it's actually something more than putting seed in the ground and reaping a harvest. It is an expression of the immutable, spiritual, unchangeable law of the kingdom of God, of cause and effect. Cause and effect. God designed that into the earth. It's one of the laws of thermodynamics. An object continues in motion until it's acted upon by an equal or opposite force. We know that something, the laws of inertia, the laws of atrophy, all of these laws that God has designed into the earth that science has investigated and proven are all a result of this primary law of the kingdom of God, cause and effect. There's a scripture in the Old Testament that says the curse cannot causeless come. In other words, you can't be walking in a cursed life unless there's a cause. And this is not karma where, you know, dualism or Taoism where good and bad balance each other. That's, no. You sow bad, you reap bad. There's not a balance to this thing. It's what you sow, you reap. And you don't reap if you don't sow. In other words, you don't have an effect of some kind unless you have done something causal. And there are limitations to us. The two basic limitations that we face as people, as created beings, humans, are a lack of capacity and a lack of volume. We either don't have the goods or we don't have the capacity to hold the amount of the goods that we need. There's a scripture in the Bible that says he gives a greater grace. In other words, you can have an increase of grace in your life. But oftentimes grace comes, and because we have not been faithful, we don't have the capacity to even receive it. The testing of our faith produces endurance. What does that mean? When your faith is tested, in the testing, capacity is being increased in you. We'd say someone who can't run a marathon, they can't even run once around the track without passing out. How could they possibly run a marathon? So what does the testing, the practicing around the track do? It's producing capacity. Endurance is another word for capacity. It creates the ability for your lungs to receive and process more oxygen. Cause and effect. 2 Timothy chapter 2, that was kind of an intro there. Just draw a line underneath that. Now we'll get to what we're really going to talk about. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15 says, "Be diligent to present yourself as approved to God, a workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth." The scripture does not exist for us to memorize and carry around in our back pocket. It exists so that we can study it. It is written so that we would understand God. God wants to be known by mankind. And he has preserved the scripture so that we can read it and know about him and understand him. Not just so that we can have knowledge of what he's done. How many of you love the stories? I mean, I love, you know, the book of Genesis. It's got all the great stories, right? But the rest of the scripture exists as well, so that not only do we just know, head knowledge, the stories, but that we understand why those stories unfolded the way they did. And once we understand it, then we can apply it to our lives. Otherwise, it's just another story. It's someone else's story that we're reading about. But when I understand it, I see that, oh, the same way that unfolded with them in that situation, with those relationships, with that kind of attitude, that's why it unfolded like it did. Cause and effect. Sowing and reaping. So we're to be diligent to present ourselves as approved of God. Workmen, what does workmen indicate? Some folks that are busy working. We're involved, right? We're not just couch potatoes. You're not just pew sitters. We're not just church attenders. We are partners with God in the earth. We are workmen with him that do not need to be ashamed. How many of you have ever gotten a result from doing something and you looked at it and you thought, that was a lousy job? Okay, that's what the Bible talks about being ashamed. There have been times I've tackled something and I did not have the skill level to do it well. I remember when I was a kid building my first birdhouse. I thought, I want to build a birdhouse. Okay, and so I gave it my first shot. And I look at it now and it's like, that was a lousy attempt at a birdhouse. I was a kid. I didn't have the capacity or the skill set to do it well. That came over time with learning, right? If I build a birdhouse now, it looks pretty nice. I've got grandkids that are trying to build birdhouses, and the word trying was gentle. there were attempts at building stuff. Stuff gets nailed together with scrap pieces of lumber around a work site, and you go, oh, that's nice. What is it? And they go, a birdhouse. You go, oh, sure. That's how great some of them look. We're all like that. On our first attempt, oftentimes, we lack the capacity or the ability to do something well. But God's plan for us is that we would fulfill our destinies. He's working in our lives to build capacity and bring us to a place where we can access a greater grace. Yeah, I always loved how Jim Douceau played guitar. And how he could, he'd just pick up an instrument and whatever he would begin to play would create an environment or an atmosphere that just always seemed so appropriate. But he didn't just fall into that. He studied music, and I remember talking to him about if you have a four chord progression and you have two minors, it almost becomes moody and dark and dirge-like and mournful. And if you eliminate one of those minors and you replace it with a major, it becomes an anthem that you just want to sing it over and over again. And we began to, he says, oh, look at this song, you know, that's a popular song. And don't you love the chorus? And the chorus, sure enough, it was exactly what, he didn't just know music, he understood what it did. And when we understand how something works, it makes us masters rather than newbies or wishful thinkers. God wants us to be masters in life. He wants us to have understanding. In Proverbs, the Bible says, by wisdom a house is built, and by understanding it is established. And with knowledge, it's filled. How many ever been to someone's home that they're a junk collector? Or what the common word for it is a hoarder. It's full of stuff. But you walk in and you go, these folks, there's some things they don't understand. So they've applied knowledge, that's valuable, that might be worth something in the future. And they've hoarded all these potential treasures, but with the understanding of, you can't even live in the house anymore. So by wisdom the house is built, by understanding it's established, and by knowledge it's filled. And we don't want to get the cart before the horse. We want to get these in the right order. We want to understand how the kingdom works. And then once we understand how it works, let's use also the knowledge we have and let's experience all these good and wonderful things. Because every destiny of every one of us sitting in this room is nothing short of glorious. What you were born for was wonder, adventure, glory. Every one of us. And if we're anywhere short of that, like me, I'm way short of what God has planned for me. How about you? Anybody else? Right now, you're living way short of it. It's an issue of capacity, the ability to hold, or the lack of holding enough of this thing called grace. Grace is a big deal to God. You know, by grace you were saved. Through faith, not of yourselves, it was a gift of God. But grace is this wonderful spiritual, to describe it's almost impossible, I just call it spiritual mojo. It's this wonderful, powerful, to be desired, to give your life for it, substance, spiritual something, that if we have it, everything becomes a possibility. And without it, failure is sure. Grace is the determining factor and the amount of that grace that depends on whether or not we enter the heavenly kingdom. By grace you've been saved, right? So even salvation, entry, is dependent on grace. And to what degree we succeed in the purposes for which we were created are dependent upon grace. I love the scripture where the Apostle Paul says about grace. He says, you know, all of these things that I have accomplished. And then he pauses and he says, well, not I. I didn't accomplish them. But the grace that is at work in me accomplished them. We got to shift our brains. Grace is the fuel. Grace is that supernatural empowerment, enablement in a good way. You know, the word enable, you know, kind of gets a bad rap sometimes because we think of people with addictions whenever we say enablers. But grace is what makes us able. It enables us. It powers us. Grace is the thing we need more than anything else. So the Holy Spirit, He deals with us not according to what we know right now, because knowledge just by itself, it just puffs us up anyways, the Bible says. Makes us proud. He doesn't deal with us according to our knowledge base. He deals with us according to what we should be understanding. And for me, I've been in the Lord 41 years, and there are some days that I feel relatively stupid. I think I should have known that. I should have figured that out. How about you, Terry? I see you shaking your head, right? How many years have you been in the Lord? 51. So you're 10 years my senior. You're my big brother. I love you. So you're nodding your head. Even you think that thought, don't you? There are times where life unfolds, and then you have an insight that the Holy Spirit speaks to you, and you go, oh, God, you're right. I should have. How did I miss that the first? If I'd have known that, if I'd have awakened to that truth 20 years ago, I could have saved myself a whole ton of trouble. Anybody else thought those thoughts? Okay. So a great harvest is preceded by a great sowing. cause and effect. Now, I'd like you to take this idea and apply it to, you know, just take down some notes as the Holy Spirit's speaking to you in between and through what I'm saying. So don't just take notes on what I'm saying. Listen to what the Holy Spirit would say to you, as even I might take something that's incomplete and maybe I even misspeak. But in the context of what we're talking about, who's our great teacher? The Holy Spirit, right? So I'm just up here. I'm just, you know, like I'm the mannequin, you know, and he's the one that really is communicating to us this morning. So let's listen to him. What would he spark within yours and my hearts to say, this is an application of that? I want to help you here, because he's a teacher and he's also our paraclete, right? Our helper. So he's desperately trying to help us, isn't he, Los? So great harvest is preceded by great sowing. When a man's ways please the Lord, he causes, there's that word causes even his enemies to be at peace with him. So when I'm having struggles in different areas, if I want those struggles relationally resolved, my number one go-to scripture is, if my ways are pleasing to the Lord, he makes a promise to me. He doesn't say when it will come to pass. He doesn't say he's going to eliminate all persecution. But at some point, my enemies will be at peace with me if my ways are pleasing to the Lord. It's a promise in Scripture. If a man's ways are pleasing to the Lord, he causes even his enemies to be at peace with him. I think of the story of Abraham, all those wells he dug. I don't know if you read through Genesis. You know, Abraham, he was a Bedouin, lived in tents, moved from here to there. But he didn't just move from here to there. He moved from one dry place to another dry place, or a dry place to a watered place. They're always looking for water for their flocks, right? And if there wasn't an existing well, they would go somewhere as God led them, and then they'd dig a well. And Abraham dug these wells, and then in the days of, I think it was King Abimelech, there was warfare between some folks and Abraham's folks, and a lot of those wells got stuffed up. And then Isaac comes into prominence, Abraham's son. And the first thing Isaac does as a son who's now in charge is he reopens all the wells his father dug. And as they are, and as there's one guy that just wasn't at peace with him and was considered himself his adversary, and it doesn't make any sense because Isaac did nothing to provoke it. And he's just against him, talking bad about him, maneuvering around him. And as Isaac is redigging and reopening the last of the wells that his father dug that had been closed by his enemies, this guy who's Isaac's enemy suddenly has this thought. And he says, why have we been giving this guy trouble all these years? He says it to his servants. And they go, oh, I guess. We don't know what they said, but they're probably, you're the boss. You said we got a problem with him. We got a problem with him. The chief says there's a problem with the other tribe. There's a problem with the other tribe, right? So he sends a delegation, and as the delegation is on their way, before they get to Isaac, Isaac's guys come to him and say, hey, we struck water. The well's open again. And no sooner are those guys given their report that their once enemies come and says, I think it was Abimelech, who wants to make a treaty with you, wants to have a partnership, wants to welcome you. This guy that's been opposed to him forever and a day suddenly wants to be his friend. Cause and effect. This is, the Bible reveals the heart of God to us, how God works. When a man's ways please, before this verse was written, it was part of God's kingdom belief system. And Isaac, in his ways of honoring his dad and his dad's life work and reopening those wells that some boneheads plugged up, I'm going to honor my dad by reopening those wells. His ways were pleasing to the Lord. And God called even his arch enemy to be at peace with him. And just how the story is told in the book of Genesis and how it unfolds, it's so obvious a proof that there is cause and effect. If God says, this is how it's going to come about, this is how it's going to come about. And it's not going to come about because I'm whining or crying or begging God for help. Because the Holy Spirit does not deal with us according to what we know. He deals with according to what we should know. We should know that the kingdom of God works by cause and effect. And if I'm having a difficulty, and that's the effect that is in force in my life, I need to find the cause. I need to study the scripture. I need to seek it. Who finds? The one who seeks. But we think the one who finds is the one who throws up a feeble prayer of asking. God doesn't say, he who asks finds. He says, he who seeks finds. It is required of us that we dig. That we dig deep for the answers that trouble us. For the situations and events of our lives that are not pleasing and peaceful, we need to get digging and find what is the causal factor that will change all this. Life not going well with you? You're middle-aged and at the point of death? Boy, the first place I'd look is the first commandment with a promise. Honor your mom and dad. That it might go well with you, and that you might live long on the earth. Cause and effect. Promise, result. Amen? Psalm 91, we all like to quote that. Let's go there. Psalm 91. And someone who gets there first, just go ahead and begin reading it for us. Psalm 91. I think it starts out, he who dwells, right? If that doesn't mess it up. Is that got kind of the traditional translation? Oh. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge, my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Here it is, I say, voice activated. It is he who delivers you from the snare of the trapper and from the deadly pestilence. Now, all of these promises of deliverance, who are they being made to? They're not being made to me unless I'm qualified. Unless I'm, verse 1, dwelling. That word dwell and the word abide, it's the same word. It's the same idea. Right? I'm not at a hotel just rooming for the night. It's my dwelling. It's where I live. He who lives in the shelter of the Most High will be living in the shadow of the Almighty. And then that guy will say, and let's go on now again to verse 3. It is he who delivers you from the snare of the trapper and from the deadly pestilence. Well, yeah. Because I'm dwelling in his presence. I'm abiding in him. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you may seek refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and a bulwark. So that's got the picture of a mother eagle protecting her young, right? With her wings and her strong feathers. But who is that mother eagle protecting? The little baby eagle that's snuggled in there. So the question really would be, am I snuggling or am I struggling? Snuggle, don't struggle. You're out there on your own, you're struggling. the option for protection and deliverance, according to all these promises that we like to quote in Psalm 91, is to the one who's snuggling in. The Lord is my refuge. He's my shelter. Yeah, he's surrounding you. He is our shelter. He's our rock of refuge. He's our high tower. We run into it for protection. We don't stand outside the tower and say, I need protection from the arrows of the enemy. It's like, no, he who runs in to the rock and the shelter and the fortress has protection. You don't stand outside the door and just quote the scripture because you know it. You run into the shelter because you understand how it works. The protection is in him, not outside of him, repeating memory verses. So we don't want to be anywhere that we are walking in the memory verse. Well, I got a scripture for that. And we're just throwing scriptures out there. We don't need to be just hearers of the word. We need to be doers of the word. And if we're not doing it, actually running into him, abiding in him, dwelling in him, we shouldn't be surprised at how lousy life is. Does that make sense? So when we understand it, now our behavior changes, and as we produce a good work, that's what your behavior is. It's a good work. We were Ephesians chapter 2, right around verse 10. We are his workmanship, created for good works in Christ. So the doing part is essential. The doing without speaking is useless. But the speaking without doing doesn't work either. We get them both in line. And what precedes the doing? I get it. I understand it. Aha! We have that aha moment that Terry and I were talking about. If I had just seen this 10 years ago, I could have saved myself all this trouble. Exactly. So we want to study to show ourselves approved. Workmen who don't need to be ashamed. For 10 years in the future, I don't know what the future holds. So my only recourse now is to just be diligent in my study. I don't know specifically what you need to study. And quite frankly, you won't know either. But that's why we're led by the Holy Spirit. He knows what's coming 10 years in the future, 5 years in the future. You never know what's going to befall your family. All you can do is be listening to the voice of the Lord today, studying the scripture, and doing your best to obey him. That's our only hope. We are not prognosticators. We know all the events of our future, so we know exactly what to do today. This is why we are dependent on the Holy Spirit. And whatever grace he's going to bring to us will be enough. I will rebuke the devourer on your behalf. I was talking, when I was down in Belize, I was talking to a guy who was a crawfish farmer. Matter of fact, he just cleared 80 acres. He was in Belize. He actually cleared 80 acres in Louisiana, basically mortgaged the family's future to start this business that he believed God told him to start. And quite frankly, I agree with him. Clears 80 acres, bulldozers, shallow ponds, building little, waterways to drain the ponds. And he's going to raise crawfish. How many of you know Louisiana crawfish are king, right? Lobsters are king in Maine. Crawfish are king in Louisiana. And 80 acres, I'm thinking, man, I got 35 acres. That's a huge chunk of land, 80 acres. All the expense of clearing that and prepping that. And then he has to seed it. So he fills it with water, and he seeds those ponds with baby crawfish, okay? And then they grow, and then they have babies, and the reproduction cycle in a year, is you have a harvest after a year, 9 months or 10 months or something like that. And he's all excited about it. And I said, man, that sounds great. He says, yeah. And he says, God showed us that we need to, in this business venture, we need to especially be faithful with our tithes and offerings. And so this is a giver. And I'm thinking, yeah, absolutely. And so the scripture comes into my mind. You know, how God admonishes us to be faithful with our tithes and our offerings. And if we are, he will rebuke the devourer on our behalf. He says, you would not believe what happened when we seeded all of those baby crawfish into those 80 acres of ponds. He says, it was like $250,000 of baby crawfish to seed it in hopes that we would have like a $2 million harvest. But it was a $250,000 investment. And he says, no sooner did we seed it, that guess what happened? I thought, man, all the blue herons, all the storks, man, all the birds. What does the scripture say in the parable of the sower and the reaper? Some seed falls here, 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 and immediately the birds come to eat the seed. And sure enough, he's telling me the story, and it's the very picture. And he says, I got really nervous about that. And I says, wow. You're tithing and you're giving your offerings. He says, yeah. And he says, and then as I'm standing there thinking about this, watching what looks to me like that's probably a lot of birds, all the neighbors started coming over who've got ponds and crawfish businesses all in the area. And they come over and they say, where's all the birds? And he says, what do you mean, where's all the birds? They're right there. And they say, those aren't all the birds. When we seed our ponds, oh my goodness, we got to stand over there with shotguns and nets and flags and hire half the community and the kids to walk around with flags to scare all the birds. What you've got going in is like a thousandth of what we deal with for birds. What's going on? Well, we got two principles at work. Does God always provide for the birds? If he loves you to provide for you, certainly he provides for the birds, right? So God doesn't hate the birds. They're going to eat. They're going to have food. But when they show up in force to devour your stuff, you want the Lord rebuking that devouring spirit, not just that merciful feed the poor little cute, gorgeous birds, right? What he was experiencing was a fraction of what everybody else experienced. And they all said to him, and here they said it out of their own mouths, his competition, you're going to have a big harvest. If that's all the birds that are here, you're going to have a bumper crop of a harvest. He says, I turned to him and says, yes, I agree with that. I agree with that. Cause and effect. You see how it works? Sometimes what you think is bad isn't that bad. It's just persecution. But because you understand how it works, the blessing of the Lord, the activity of angels, that's all part of that to move it forward to your benefit. I remember when I used to think, you know, I get a flat tire and I'm going to rebuke the devourer, and I find out that everyone else who's got a car that old, their engines are blown up and, you know, their alternator's not working. And every month they've got a major expense and I'm complaining about a tire. Lord, I thought you'd rebuke the devourer. And it's like, John, suck it up. Yeah. You're going to have an occasional flat tire. This is more like lemon protection. God wants to bring us into life and not destruction. He wants to bring us into life and not destruction. Broad and easy is the way that leads to destruction. Narrow and not readily used is the path that leads to life. So when I'm making decisions, if my grid for making decisions is, I just always look for the easiest way to get something done. You're in violation of something you should have studied. Well, I took that job, and they offered me so much more money, and it's just across the street, and everything was so easy, and sounds like an Ishmael to me, not an Isaac. choosing something that's always the easiest and having that as being our decision-making grid flies in the face of what Jesus said. He's standing with his disciples walking down a road, and there's a broad path and a narrow path. And he says, that broad path, you know, the one where you can see clearly on either side and all that, and, you know, it's well-traveled, and that's easy, all the big stones are out of the way, that one leads to destruction. But then there's this narrow path over here that leads to life. Which one are you going to choose? Which one's easier? If easy is your grid, you're going to be choosing the wrong path most of the time. Why? Because we didn't take that seriously, or we didn't know. One of the two. And so I have to study to show myself approved. Holy Spirit led you to that intersection, but he's not now dealing with you according to what you know. The choice is yours according to what you should know by now. You know, as believers, if we spent maybe just 15 minutes a day reading the scripture, we would easily have blown through the entire Bible in a year. It doesn't take that long if you break it up into small bites of 15 minutes a day. A little bit of the Old Testament, a little bit of the New Testament, 15 minutes a day. You can get through the Old Testament easily, probably the New Testament two or three times, all together in a year, where any of the things I'm saying today would not be unfamiliar to us. But how many of us have lived a substantially long Christian life and maybe haven't read through the Bible even once? Well, right now, you're probably feeling a little bit of uneasiness about that. That's what the Revelation calls the shame of our nakedness. And we need to buy from him. We need to work. We need to earn. We need to be diligent and faithful. Apply ourselves to study. I'm in the process of writing a book. I'm in the process of writing a lot of books. But this book, excuse the raw language, it's called 31 Reasons Life Sucks. Because I get so tired of hearing people say, oh, my life just sucks. Well, there are reasons. And these are the reasons. And we can solve it. God has not, you didn't just get a bum deal, and God didn't deal you a bad hand in life. He has the best in store for us. He has provided us everything we need for life and godliness, success in him. And if we're not walking in it, there are reasons why we're not walking in it. And I'm drawing from some of that material here this morning. All right. Anytime you see the word inheritance in the Bible and you want to claim that scripture, remember, who does the inheritance go to? Sons and daughters, do you have a relationship with God? Have you been fostering that relationship with Father God? Or is Father still a word that is disgusting to you, intimidating to you, one that causes you to draw back because of your life's history? Understandable. But if you know that the inheritance goes to sons and daughters and those that are walking that way relationally, as well as with others in this life, then all of those promises that are part of our inheritance, I've got some alignment issues to take care of. As I take care of those relational alignment issues, that's a causal factor that brings me now into the blessings of sonship and daughterhood. Does that make sense? That's why that's an issue with the Lord. It's not because he's trying to correct us. He looks at our lives and saying, that's a weak spot. I want you to get that fixed. Just go ahead and sharpen up. No, he's saying, this is causing a hindrance, and I love you enough to confront this because you're not just living below your potential. You're living below the blessing level that I have planned for you. And he wants to bring us. God desperately wants to bring us into greater blessing. He loves us that much. He's not the judge who's sitting far away just watching the affairs of men, making judgments about us. He's a loving, doting, grandpa-like father who is looking for every excuse to flood our lives with presents and blessings and good things But if we are hindering him by closing ourselves in our closet and having our little temper tantrum, demanding our own way, then he's just going to, like any good parent, he's just going to let you wear yourself out. He's not going to try to coax you out of that by dangling blessings in front of you. No, if you just quit complaining, you could have a candy bar. There are times he stands back and he says, you need to know how this works. So start digging. Dig it out. Some of this is heated up in my mind and my heart because of my work in Belize, that the Lord's given me a national platform there to speak into ministry as well as business and media and other areas of society. And the nation has a greater need for justice than any other place I know of on the planet. And Luke chapter 18 says how justice moves, how justice flows from God, from the courts of heaven into the earth. And it flows to his elect. And Jesus used a very interesting word in this parable, before the elect of God, which is us, born again in Christ, even existed, he prophesied concerning us and says, your Father will bring forth justice speedily to his elect. So there's a qualifier. Not religious people, but his elect who cry out to him day and night. And I believe that's the reason and the push for 24/7 prayer in the earth. Is God is looking at our affairs, looking at our political problems, looking at our economic problems, and saying, I want to make those things right. I want to deal justly with them. I want to pour justice on them. But I'm a just God, and I cannot break my own rules of the kingdom. I cannot legally do for them what they refuse to qualify themselves for. Remember, the scene in heaven between light and darkness is the devil just watches and he brings accusation against God. Remember the story of Job. That's a story of God being a just and loving God. You're just blessing him because you like him. He's your favorite just because you like him, that good old Job guy. If you did this, he'd curse you to your face. And the circumstances unfolded as even after having lost everything, Job's very own wife says, man, throw your hands in the air, just curse God and die. I mean, even the closest voice of comfort in his life had turned under the pressure, but Job did not. And God says, I've known this about this guy forever, but now there's evidence. No longer will he ever entertain an accusation against Job. Job proved it. He proved what the will of God is. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. He proved himself to be a man who sought after God, and he was not ashamed. God draws near when we draw near. If I'm going to have my own business, my own ministry, my own whatever, God will give me my own after I've proven myself faithful in what belongs to somebody else. If I end up with my own before I've been faithful in what belongs to someone else, it was probably of my own manipulation and my own doing, and it's going to come crashing down. I have to be not just working for someone else, I have to be faithful in what belongs to someone else. If I'm faithful in what belongs to another, God then will mark me as qualified to have my own. See, the applications of this stuff, this is huge, isn't it? Every area of our lives, cause and effect, understanding the law of sowing and reaping, cause and effect. If there's a certain effect I am desiring, how do I get it? I'll give you the nations as your inheritance. Well, how do you end up with a nation as your inheritance? One city at a time, maybe. How do you get a city? God to say, you got the keys of that city. There's an anointing on you to win that city for me. How does that happen? Parable of the minas. Faithful in unrighteous mammon, God will give you a city. Faithful in a lot of unrighteous mammon, God will give you 2 cities, 5 cities. To the same degree you've proved yourself faithful in earthly things, God will give you, trust you with, spiritual things. Faithful with a little increase, or when I'm faithful with a little, it increases my capacity for more. God's dream for me, God's dream for you, is a big dream. And then there's this scripture. So don't despise small beginnings. Because that's where it starts. It's the building of capacity. So let me give you some paradoxical thoughts here about the kingdom of God. How do you win? You lose to win. How do you live? You die to live. How do you gain? You give to gain. How do I receive? I release to receive. So Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 and 10, if you want to write that down, I'm going to close with this thought. Matthew chapter 5, verse 3, Matthew chapter 5, verse 10. It's basically the same result. You want to get the kingdom of heaven? This is how you get it. Blessed are the poor in spirit. What does that mean? Blessed are those who are emptied. Emptied of what? Emptied of yourself. You can't get full of something spiritually unless you're empty of its counterpart. It doesn't mean walking around poor with no money. It specifically says poor in spirit. In other words, in a spiritual sense, you are empty. You're empty of yourself. You're not full of yourself. How many of you know someone who's full of themselves? It's disgusting, right? How many of us have ever been full of ourselves to a degree, right? Join me? Amen. We can all fall prey to that. So when I choose to live selflessly, when I choose to take up my cross and follow him and die to myself, okay, that's the ultimate emptying, dying to myself, what do I gain? I gain heavenly things. When I let go of my stuff, my affections, I gain his stuff and his affections. But how many times have we cried, Lord, I just want more of you. I want more of you. And then our ears go deaf. But a heavenly voice is saying, so empty yourself of yourself. Lord, I just want more of you. I just want you to be icing on my cake. And God says, no, you got to get rid of your cake. I'm going to give you a new cake and new icing. I want to give you the whole new thing. No, Lord, I want to keep my cake. And I want to eat it too, but can you just pour icing all over me? Oh, I want more of you. What is this person actually crying out for? More feeling, more emotion, more goosebumps, more self-delusion that he's actually close to the Lord because he felt his touch? No, God say, no. You want more of me, and you want it to stick? Empty yourself of yourself. So Matthew chapter 5, 3 and 10. Here we've got in Acts chapter 16, verse 22. And following, the story of Paul and Silas in prison. I love this story. Paul and Silas are in prison. They get there because they've been testifying about Jesus, and a mob rises up in this particular town, strips their clothes off of them, beats them with rods, throws them into prison. Okay? While they're in prison, what are they doing? How many know the story? Worshiping. Praising, actually, but worshiping, we might call it today. They're singing songs and praising God. All of a sudden, in the midst of their praising and singing, there's a what? An earthquake. How many of us can see enough with spiritual eyes to know that was not like a normal earthquake? That was a spiritually caused earthquake in response to them singing and praising. Emptying themselves of themselves. Blessed are you, verse 10 says in Matthew 5, when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake, for yours is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when you are persecuted for righteousness' sake. How many of y'all, that's a tough one for me. Any kind of persecution, I find it difficult not to just get ticked off about that. Why in the world are they giving me such a hard time? I'm just trying to bless them. All I did was I said the truth. How come everyone's responding so crazy? I remember I wrote a newspaper article one time about Jesus. In the religious section of the Brunswick newspaper, Jesus being the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through him. Basic Christian theology. I received more hate mail from people claiming to be Christians that I had the audacity to say that Jesus was the way and inferring that he's the only way. And I thought, well, I did more than infer. I said he's the only way. But they were crazed. I got like 7, 8, 9 letters, because this is before email. Before it was popular back in the day. People sat down, took time to write letters, burned the expense of a stamp, had to figure out my address. They had to really look to give me a hard time. And then to persecute me like that for saying something that is so easily true to every one of us in this room. Persecuted for righteousness' sake. And I heard the Lord say to me, well, how are you going to respond to that? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And I just decided to praise. I remember whenever Israel got in Moses' face, what would Moses do? He'd fall on his face and worship the Lord. He didn't even bother engaging. He just praised. I thought, I got to do that. So I did. You say, well, did those people there write back? Are they part of the church? Nah. We're not shooting for the end result. We're just shooting to get the process right. If we just get the process right, the end result will take care of itself, right? So here's Paul and Silas. They're in prison. Suddenly, their bands are loose. The doors fly open. I mean, this must be one. How many of you know if you're shackled and there's an earthquake and suddenly your shackles, your handcuffs become undone? That's not a natural earthquake, right? That's what I'm saying. There's something spiritual going on. There are angels shaking things, sticking their fingers into the keyhole of your handcuffs. I mean, this is a spiritual event. What did they do? Hallelujah, we're free. We're out of trouble. No. They sat there, and they were more concerned with the jailer because it was the Roman habit. If the prisoners get loose and you are in charge of the prison, you might as well kill yourself now. Because if you don't kill yourself, they're going to torture you and kill you because you blew it. So kill yourself. It's easier. And they realize he's about ready to fall on his own sword and commit Harry Carey, right? And all of a sudden they shout out, don't kill yourself. We're all still here. This also tells me it wasn't just a normal earthquake. The fear of God was probably on everyone's face as all of their chains were loosed. And when Paul and Silas cried out, said, we're all still here, no one else was bolting for the door either. They're probably like, oh, something's going on. I ain't moving. I ain't moving. Everyone just sat there. The jailer comes in. Make sure everyone else's manacles are back in place, all the doors are closed up, and he takes Paul and Silas to his home, feeds them, tends to their wounds, they have dinner, Paul and Silas preach to him, the entire household gets saved, and then he takes them right back into prison. Think about it. Because the next morning, they want to release them. Because they found out that they were Romans, and they beat them without a trial. And so all the town leaders are like, whoa, let's get those guys out of prison. And Paul and Silas say, we ain't leaving. Let them come get us themselves. That's a godly attitude. What are Paul and Silas sitting there doing? Totally confident, because they know what's going on. They know how this thing works. Their goal wasn't to get out of prison anyways. They rejoiced when they were persecuted for his name's sake and thrown into prison and beaten. They wanted the testimony of Jesus to be known by the entire world. That was their motivation. They were empty of their own purposes and agenda. Kind of like Mary, when the angel appeared to her, "Let it be done to me according to your will." That's what Paul and Silas are saying. "Let it be done to me according to your will, Lord." But they knew how it worked, and they were at peace in the midst of the earthquake, in the midst of the scramble to get free, in the midst of being released without a trial by the wrong people. They says, They're going to release us, having beaten us while we were Romans. They can come in here and get us themselves. We're not leaving prison till they come and get us. I don't know about you, but I know about me. I'm in some Central American jail somewhere. I'm like, get me out of here, right? But not these guys, because they understood something. One of my favorite lines, "I know something you don't know." Well, we all need grace. We need that. They were full of grace. They were humble. They were empty of themselves. And in response, they were full of grace, a greater grace. So here's the closing thought. Choose not to be offended at your perceived treatment. Throw yourselves into the arms of your loving Heavenly Father. Don't complain, but rather sing his praises, and then watch and be amazed. I'll read those again. First, you have to choose not to be offended at your perceived treatment. Once you're offended, you've lost the battle. If Paul and Silas were offended at the jailer, offended at their persecutors, offended with God at their situation. "God, all these times we've so faithfully served you, and we're in jail again." Remember Paul's testimony. How many times has he been beaten with rods? How many times, shipwrecked, a night and a day floating around in the ocean? I mean, he goes through this litany. I'm sure that at the end of that list, each time one of these things happened, it would have been his human fallen nature to say, "God, not again? Haven't I been through enough for you?" But he didn't. Here he is in one of those times, at rest, at peace, bloody, clothes all torn up, sitting in a dank cell, rats running around the floor, and he does not say, "Lord, what did I do to deserve this?" He refused to not be offended with the jailer, refused to not be offended with his persecutors, and he refused to not be offended with the big guy, God. Because that's really where we lose it. So choose not to be offended at your perceived treatment. Rather, throw yourselves into your rock, your high tower, your shelter, the one in whom you sing about abiding in. Actually, snuggle in there and abide. Don't complain. That just, when you're complaining, now you're cursing and not blessing. You're destroying your own future. Don't complain. But rather, sing his praises and watch and be amazed. I know for some of us, we're in some tough spots. This is very applicable to where you might be today. If you're not in a tight spot today, I can guarantee you one thing. You'll be in a tight spot soon. Because persecution comes to us. Jesus said, "Hey, if I've been persecuted, you guys aren't going to escape it either. We're going to not just be persecuted, you're going to be unjustly accused, unjustly persecuted. It's going to sting. But we know what to do. We need his grace. We need grace to move into the future of what he has for us. And so we need to have, eventually we'll have the heart of Paul, these light afflictions." He goes through the list of how many times he's been beaten, in jail, shipwrecked, and he goes, "But these light afflictions, light afflictions compared to the glory that he is called to walk in, to realize. Amen. Honey, I see you feverishly taking notes. You want to add anything, say anything? Let's all stand. And as we're standing, we're not going to be immediately dismissed. I just want to give you time to, if you feel like the Lord has really spoken to you about some things, to really get some time where you run into him. So kind of in, we don't do this very often. We don't usually refer to this area as the altar. But if that's the language that you understand, the altar is open, the front is open. If you want to, we just ask everyone here to be sensitive to whoever's next to you. If you want to just turn and just put your face into your chair and just have a conversation with the Lord. I learned a long time ago that when the Lord deals with me in something, I want to be quick to respond. I don't want to be dismissed and then drive home, all the distraction, the craziness of the day, and then try to find a quiet place where I can deal with what was stirring in my heart 2 hours ago. And I know that oftentimes when we gather together, the Lord tweaks some places in our hearts, and it is wisdom on our part to respond quickly and immediately. And I encourage you to do that. If the Lord has sparked anything in your heart that you know needs adjustment, a place of where you've been offended and you need to let that go, run into his arms, let him be your refuge. We just want to take time to do that. So if the sound booth could put on some appropriate music for us. Yeah, why don't you play that while, just go ahead and start that. Wow. Good ending for us. Something's going to be playing out here. You can watch that as well. Let's pray. Just go ahead and keep that playing. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your kind, gentle, merciful way that you deal with us, that you go right to the core of our issues and you help us. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. So just find a place where you can do your business with the Lord. You can be seated if you'd like to be seated.
In the darkness he replied, Silas, I am here.